guide, and then he'll do some questions and answers for you. Chet Orloff, historian, that's the main word that comes to mind. He's had a long and distinguished career as a historian, and for our interest tonight, he has served as manager of the Pamplin International Collection of Art and History since 2003. He's director emeritus of the Oregon Historical Society, which he directed in the 1990s, and where he served for over two decades. He is president and director of the International Museum of the City. Chet has served on many state, national, and international boards and committees on history, planning, and museums. He's also a teacher. He started his teaching career in the Peace Corps in Afghanistan in the early 70s, if you can imagine the trial by fire. He has been an adjunct professor at Portland State, where I worked with him sometimes, in urban studies and planning for the last 15 years. And he's been on the faculty at U of O in their Portland architecture program for the last 5 years. He has a BS in anthropology and history from Boston University and U of O, and a master's in history and public history from Portland State. I could go on about journals edited, public talks given, task forces served on, the Friends of Simon Benson House that we served on together, and so on. But you want to hear from Chet about the Pamplin Collection. So welcome, Chet Orloff.
Thank you. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Can you all hear me?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, that's good. I spent 4 hours in class today lecturing, so I'm lectured out, much to your, I'm sure, relief. So you're not going to get a too formal a talk today, tonight. So what I'm actually going to talk about is, to some extent, the Pamplin Collection, but I'm going to use the collection to illustrate Edward Curtis and his life, for obvious reasons. Has everyone read the book?
Yeah.
Okay. And how many of you went to Tim Egan's talk? Good, lots of people. So when I refer to that, you will know, and if you didn't go, then you won't know what I'm repeating already. First off, I brought far too few of these catalogs. Every year, we work up a catalog for that year's exhibit in the Pamplin Collection, and it's rather diverse. It's not just Native American materials a la Curtis, but art, American history, Chinese, military, American Revolution, Civil War, World War II, all over the landscape, historically and artistically. But what I'm going to do is get another stack of these and get them to Pat, or to the library, perhaps, might be more appropriate, so that if you are interested, if you see some other people, or look over people's shoulder and you'd like to get a copy, be patient. We'll get one into your hands sometime in the next week or so. So just a few words about Edward Curtis. I first started to read about Edward Curtis in the early 1970s. I bought this book in 1972. It almost looks original, in fact. You know, Curtis was, you know, he died only 20 years before this. It's an oversized book, and it's basically the size of the prints of Curtis's photographs. And I brought this along for illustrative purposes, and I'll talk a little bit about it in a moment. But just a quick side note, something about the size of Curtis prints. When we think of photographic prints, and now we don't even think of that. We think of, you know, snapshots on an iPhone or something like that, or most of us also know prints and negatives, maybe going up to 3x5 or maybe 8x10. Well, Curtis prints, by and large, were larger. In the late 90s, I got a call from some woman in Pendleton, Oregon, who said she had 5 Curtis prints. Needless to say, I dropped everything and drove out to Pendleton to pick them up. One of them was cracked because they were on glass plates. And they were about this big. And as I say, there were 5 of them, and they were heavy. So I'm thinking of Curtis going out into the countryside throughout the country with, you know, perhaps a couple hundred of these pieces of glass, very delicate. I remember carrying them out to my car and thinking, Gad, if I drop them, you know, what will happen? So you could only imagine what that must have been like for Curtis and, you know, his assistants or the people he was working with to lug boxes, wooden boxes of these things around. And having to be careful, you know, you don't just throw them on the back of a horse, although he was probably doing that to some extent. And driving them around must have been a challenge because when he was driving in a car, he was generally on unpaved roads and things were bouncing all over the place. So just the fact that he got these things back to his studios, either in Seattle or in California, Southern California, was amazing in and of itself. But, you know, just imagine images of that size on a heavy piece of glass, almost plate glass kind of surface. So Curtis, as we all know now, having read his biography and perhaps other works about him and by him, was generally untrained. He had a rudimentary education, but self-taught in photography, who really mastered the trade, the profession, and came out to Seattle, as we know, with his father, who quickly passed away, alas, and after trying his hand at other things, he made it in the field of photography, and very quickly realized that his real calling was portraying, and I use that word intentionally, portraying American Indians. And I use the word portray, as I think most of you understand, because Curtis was a portrait photographer. When I first started to learn about Curtis and look at his prints, I was looking at not only his Native American prints, but also some of the prints that images that he took of Teddy Roosevelt and others. And these were true classical portraits. I think when Curtis, I've never seen him write anything like this, but I think when Curtis was photographing people, it didn't matter whether they were Indians or whites. He was taking a photograph of a person in the true portrait sense. So we might look at these and say, oh, these are portraits of Indians. And I think he probably would have said, no, it's a portrait of people, of a person. And he may not have differentiated necessarily between, say, a Teddy Roosevelt and a Chief Joseph, for example. Whereas recently, although probably not so much now, as we learn more about Curtis and what his angle, what his approach was, he would have looked at Teddy Roosevelt or Chief Joseph or some of the others in the same way. And I think we're beginning to understand that Curtis was not just portraying, you know, an image of an Indian such as this, but he was portraying a person. And I think a lot of people look at his images of Indians and they say, well, he was staging that. Well, he was staging it in the same way he would have staged, and he did stage, say, the President of the United States when he took photographs or other formal portraits. Same kind of thing. So I think it's important that we understand Curtis and his approach to art and ethnology, the study of people. So Curtis was doing his work primarily in the first 2-3 decades of the 20th century. And that's an era that I want to focus on for a couple minutes. In the late 19th century, a host of historical societies and museums were established in the United States, from the East Coast to the West. In Oregon, we had what was called the Oregon Pioneer Association, the OPA, that was established in 1873. And these people began collecting documents, images, artifacts to document their experience of arriving here, the people they met, Native Americans, Chinese, Hawaiians, African Americans, and gathered these together. They didn't have a place to store them, so that a lot of them stored them in their basement. We can only imagine what that was like. But ultimately, by the late 19th century, 1898, the Oregon Historical Society was incorporated and began to partner with the Oregon Pioneer Association and gather materials together. Soon, once the new City Hall was opened, 1895, in downtown Portland, took some rooms there for its museum and collections, and then ultimately moved to the auditorium, now Keller Auditorium, before it was redone in the 60s. So this was an era in Oregon and up in Washington in Tacoma, where the Washington State Historical Society was going through its same kind of birthing activities and beginning to collect. So Curtis came into the Pacific Northwest, in the Puget Sound area, during an era of collecting and a very intentional sense of gathering materials that related to settling the Pacific Northwest and meeting the very people whom he ultimately would begin to portray. So I want to make sure that we understand this connection between collecting things and Curtis, who would not have been surprised at all if we began talking about this connection that he had. It would have made perfect sense to him, because in the early 20th century, museums were just getting going in the United States. They were becoming quite popular, much more popular than they are today, I suspect. People related to them in different ways, partly because they didn't have, few people had telephones, they didn't have all of the other things that distract us from museums today, like movies, the web, and whatever else we want to think about, and travel. It was an era of collecting. So collecting images of people would have fit right in with the mode and the scholarly activities, the academic activities that were going on at this time. It's also probably why someone with barely an education, I don't think he even graduated from high school, was able to work with a group of true academics from the East Coast and maintain a reputation, as Curtis did, with such high regard. So, all of this being the case, Curtis is going to work in first the Pacific Northwest. We know he's taking that famous photograph of Chief Seattle's daughter, one of the most famous photographs, portraits in American photography. And then after that, realizes his calling and begins to go out throughout the Pacific Northwest and ultimately across the country, or at least across the American West, and follow suit, taking images, which we can take a look at in this book, because this gathers together probably 100 or so of some of the finest photographs that Curtis took. What I wanted to do in talking about the Pamplin collection, Bob Pamplin's collection, Lake Oswegan Bob Pamplin collection, I should preface it, is to relate that part of our collection with Curtis. So Curtis, as we know, was working primarily from the late 19th, early 20th century up through the 20s and 30s. This was an era in American, Native American history that was, let's be blunt, dismal. It was a time when their population was declining markedly across the country, Pacific Northwest and across the country, from diseases, from depression, from alcohol issues, poverty, almost all of it driven by poverty, I should say. They were basically subsisting. And one of the ways they were subsisting, interestingly, was by recreating their art, whether it was basketry, basket weaving, beadwork, needlework, and selling these materials, these goods, to tourists. Let me just pause there and talk just a little bit about tourism. We might tend to think of tourism as being a relatively modern thing, you know, something that started after World War II when airplane travel became easier, automobile travel, everyone started driving, people started to go to Europe. Well, tourism is actually a really old tradition. It goes back several thousand years, interestingly, and a lot of the Roman and Greek objects, sculptures that we see in museums had actually been carried from Greece over to Rome by tourists and then were buried and lost and ultimately excavated and brought to museums around the country. It's kind of an interesting story. So by the 19th century, as the American West opened up, as it was, as we like to say, settled, which carries all kinds of connotations, positive and negative, which we won't go into here, but you can imagine. People began to travel out here. Europeans, especially Germans and the English, loved to come to the American West and to collect materials relating to American Indians. But Americans did too. They came with their cameras, they came with their money, and it was that support to some extent that probably nurtured and allowed some of the cultures that now are beginning to regrow, allowed them to survive through that very dismal period of American, Native American history. So the Pamplin Collection, Bob Pamplin began collecting about 40 some years ago. He came from a family of collectors. His parents were also great collectors. And he took this on with great passion, which he continues to this day. I was meeting with him on just this last week, and we were making plans for this summer's exhibit, talking about things that he had recently purchased. We just got this wonderful Navajo drum, some interesting photographs, or paintings rather, one from England, one from France. So again, the diversity of this collection. And almost every week we get a new poster. And he focuses on posters from American films, generally from the teens to the 40s and 50s. You know, a lot of silent movies, you know, the kind of classic Western films that, you know, we probably couldn't name because there were so many of them, thousands of them made, and we're building up probably the most prominent collection in the region of film posters in this area. So these are just parts of the collection that he has built. In the 1990s and early 2000s, he was really focusing on Native American materials. And in that area, we have probably over 1,000 pieces. Again, very intentionally collected. No ceremonial things. ceremonial things we feel are verboten. They're just too important, too symbolic to the people who created them and used them, and in many cases continue to use them. And we just don't feel it's appropriate to be collecting those kinds of materials. So we're looking at materials that are, by and large, are used objects, common everyday materials, used by people in various ways, whether it's for healing people or for wearing clothing. And you'll look at some of these materials and say, well, these are quite elegant in some respects. But again, they are objects that are, if not used every day, used perhaps, you know, like Sunday best kinds of things for ceremonies like weddings, not religious ceremonies, but celebrations, births, weddings, funerals, special occasions, holidays, especially the 4th of July, which was and remains a great holiday celebrated by Native Americans. So what I have brought today is a collection of things, and I'll show them to you and explain them to you, but that what I want you to do is actually get up and look at them, because, you know, I can hold them up and show them to you, but you're really not going to be able to appreciate them until you get up close. So we're going to only spend a little bit of time me gabbing about all this, because, you know, you don't need to sit here after dinner and listen to someone gabbing on, but I want you to get up and look at some of these materials and then ask some questions. And to the extent that I can answer them, I will do so. And if I don't know the answer, I'll make it up, which I'm really good at. So let me go through some of these materials and describe them. These are the kinds of materials. They date primarily from the 1880s, 1890s, to the 1920s or 30s, precisely the time when Curtis was working. Curtis himself had his own collection of materials. So, you know, imagine, if you will, these were Curtis's, because this is just the kind of thing that Curtis had in his house in Seattle and down in Los Angeles. Some of it given to him, some of it he purchased, because he was very assiduous about that. He was going to take something, he wanted to pay people for things. And if you look in many of his photographs, you'll see what appear to be staged, which they were to some extent, objects, baskets, wood carvings, cloth materials, decorated cloth materials, and clothing. And this is the kind of thing he would have brought back home, by and large, with some exceptions. The one exception, why don't I start with that, is Sitting Bull. Sitting Bull was a Sioux chief. He was one of the leaders in the Little Bighorn Battle, July of 1876, which Custer met his match, as we know, and went on to try to revive the Sioux and Plains cultures through the ghost dance. And for that, more than the fact that he had defeated the 7th Cavalry, he was basically incarcerated for the remainder of his life until he was being transferred from one prison essentially to another. And it was during one of those transfers that the cavalry, his guards who were taking him from one place to another, thought there was a conspiracy of some of his peers to help him escape, and it ended up in a gun battle, and unfortunately he was killed at that time. But we have two items here, one which is kind of an interesting piece. This is a postcard. It's the house at which Sitting Bull was was living, in which he was living at the time that he was killed. This was printed up in the early 1890s and sold at the Chicago Exposition of 1893, the Great World's Fair, the Great White Way, The Devil in the White City, I'm sure, another book you may have read. So this was the kind of thing that was printed up and sold. So it's kind of interesting that they would use that image of Sitting Bull. And then his autograph. Now, Sitting Bull did not write. I mean, there was a Sioux language written in English letters, but he writes Sitting Bull. I can only imagine that this was probably done by someone holding his hand and, you know, moving it across. His writing is better than mine. And, you know, no way that he would have done that. But in his hand. So again, this was done for collectors. He probably did dozens of these, or had, you know, allowed several of them to be made. Whether he was paid for it or not is, of course, another matter. We can only hope that that was the case. If it had been given to Curtis, he certainly would have paid for it. So those are two items unlikely that Curtis would have collected. The remainder of these materials, however, are quite Curtisan. They are just the kind of thing that he would have collected. And I've tried to put them to some extent in cultural, or at least geographic, order. Start right over here, and I'll get back here so that some of you can see. And as I say, we'll just take a few minutes to go through this, and then hope you will come up and take a closer look. These are materials from the plateau. The plateau is basically this vast region of northeastern Oregon, eastern Washington, across Idaho to the western slope of the Rocky Mountains. It includes, to some extent, part of Wyoming, but it's primarily that large area, that band of land, lakes, and rivers northeast of us. Think of the Nez Perce, the Cayuse, the Umatilla tribes. Making things, these are interestingly children's toys. But these are essentially saddlebags. Let's call them suitcases. These are the kinds of things that they were leather, buffalo leather, that was cut into large pieces, sometimes the size of this table, and you would put clothes in them and then fold them up and lace them, and then they would be carried either on a travoy, one of those triangular contraptions that with sticks, that poles that are teepee poles, essentially, that are hung off the back of a horse and dragged, because it just makes it easier to carry more weight. And you could stack these up, or you could also tie them and put them on the side of a horse if you wanted to do that. So they were quite versatile. You know, they didn't have handles and wheels like ours do today, but you could move them around the same way. And then this looks like a basket, I know, but it's actually a hat, a woman's hat, probably Nez Perce. Possibly the kind of hat that was made by the Indians who lived along the banks, both the north and south banks of the Columbia River. These were made to protect people from the sun. Makes sense. You could, it's quite, again, quite versatile. You could make it wet, you know, so it keeps your head cooler as the water evaporates. You could also turn it over if you were having considerable luck picking huckleberries or other fruits or vegetables or bulbs, and needed additional carrying capacity, as it were. So again, quite versatile. The designs of this particular item, particularly, are quite geometric. And I want to encourage you to visit an exhibit that's now down at Portland State in Lincoln Hall. It's Natalie Lynn's collection of baskets, her own collection, wonderful collection. And in the back of this catalog, which they produced, and I think you can probably pick up copies of this at Portland State through the dean's office in the College of Art at Lincoln Hall. And I really encourage you to go down and see this exhibit. Again, this is materials from 1870 to 1930, classic Curtis era of Northwest Indian materials. So again, really relates to this whole story of Curtis and the people he was portraying. But if you look at some of the images that are really well reproduced here, a lot of them highly geometric or historic. You know, they're telling a story. And if they're telling a story, they're often quite patriotic or romantic. A lot of flowers, a lot of birds, hearts, flags, things like that. And in the back, there is this poster that shows all of the pieces that are shown in the exhibit. So if you can, definitely get down there. It's only up for another week, close of the 29th. So get down there this week if you can do so. So plateau materials. Then Plains Indian. Plains tribes, the Great Plains, basically Mississippi west, Missouri River. Think of the Dakotas, Montana, and then drop down into Kansas, Nebraska, Missouri, that whole area. Large number of nations occupying that area. A story that really we began to learn about as Americans after Lewis and Clark came back, because they spent a considerable amount of time traveling through and learning about the Plains peoples. We've got a few objects here. One is, and again, I want you to come up and look at these materials. Don't touch them like I am, but look at them. I did wash my hands before I came out here and started handling them. A child's moccasins, Sioux, again, Chief Joseph's nation. Beaded all around. You know, these are not what you would put on a little kid, you know, your grandkid, and send him or her out, you know, running around, because they would be finished in no time. These are meant for indoor, walking on buffalo hide, you know, not going out and walking on the ground in the dirt and all of that, but carefully walking, and probably in most cases the child was carried, so the chance of them, you know, wearing through the threads on the beads was unlikely. Although we have dozens of pairs of moccasins, adult-sized moccasins, that are also beaded all the way around, including on the bottom. Again, worn only on special occasions, you know, for holidays, weddings, feasts, events like that. But again, very well designed and executed using beads that were quite popular. White, blue, and red beads were the most common and the most popular because they're the brightest colors. They're not natural colors, so they would naturally probably attract the eye more than the more muted colors that people would get from native dyes or ores, geologic ores. These beads probably came from Germany or Italy, Venetian glass. They were made by the billions probably first brought over here in the 17th and 18th centuries, and then became very popular as people moved west and began trading with the plains and ultimately the plateau and northwest coast tribes in the 19th and early 20th century. These objects over here, also plains tribes, except for southwest Apache, just very far southwest. This is, again, beadwork. You know, if you look at the design, it almost looks similar to the plateau tribe, Nez Perce design, more than 1,000 miles away, but this time executed in beads. This is an awl case, an awl being a tool that you would punch holes in leather. And then a knife case with some really interesting colors selected here. This is a plains knife. In other words, we don't know whether it was Sioux or Crow or Cheyenne, but it could be any of those, possibly. Combination of leather, again, buffalo leather by and large, and then beadwork. And then this is a Crow Indian rattle, probably with horse hair, horse tail hair. On the bottom, again, leather and dew claws. These are the claws from a deer, dried and tied with leather, and, you know, again, used probably for celebrations, dances, things like that. And then, finally, this set of three objects, Northwest Coast. Remember, Curtis, some of his last set of photographs were taken as he went up in the Northwest Coast, off the coast of British Columbia and Alaska. And he would have seen just these kinds of materials. These are either Haida or Tlingit. Again, the tribes lived on the coasts of southern Alaska and British Columbia and on the islands and the sound in between the islands, Vancouver Island and other islands going up north. Three distinctly different objects. One is a bag, like a purse, could have been used or made for the trade, for the tourist trade, or it could have been used by the Indians themselves. It's trade cloth, two colors of trade cloth. Trade cloth was basically fabric that was brought by European and American explorers and traders and traded to the Indians for food or furs. Very popular because, you know, they didn't have cloth. And so this trade cloth, very heavy, tough material. And again, the blue and the red were the most popular. And again, decorated with beads and with buttons. The Northwest Coast Indians were really taken with buttons. It's interesting. You've probably seen at the Portland Art Museum some of the blankets and capes from the Northwest Coast that are decorated with buttons. Same as the case here. This is a horn spoon, probably a mountain sheep horn. Basically what they would do is, you know, if you imagine the horn curling around like that, you would steam it. You'd put it in a bowl that had hot water, again water boiled with stones that had been heated up in a fire, and it would soften the horn such that you could split it and then pull it apart and shape it. So you see bowls, spoons like this, and then it's carved a bit, so it's got it looks like a face sorry about the tag there, but I try to put tags on everything we get so that I don't lose what it is and all of that. But it has a face carved into it. And then finally this piece, which we got a couple of years ago, and I'm really fascinated with this piece, Tlingit. The Northwest Coast Indians were slavers. They practiced raids on each other, taking slaves who they would use for labor. They would use for wives. And they would also kill them quite willingly as part of the potlatch customs that went on. This is a piece that's kind of interesting. It's a pipe. Here's where you'd put the tobacco in here in this part. And then this is where you would draw it from. And it's carved so that it has probably a killer whale face here. And then it looks like a small frog or a toad there. And then probably a raven, maybe an eagle, or osprey perhaps here. And then fascinating, a slave, a woman. You can see her breasts. And then her guard is holding her hair in the back here that you can see, pulling it back. And her hands are tied behind her back. So again, come up here and take a look at this. This is carved wood. So these are some of the objects I wanted to point out. And then finally, Curtis was a documentarian. He was not only portraying people, but by virtue of that, he was also documenting what people looked like, what they were doing, what they were wearing. In the late 19th century, a practice began of the Plains Indians primarily. Other tribes did this, but primarily this was done on the plains, began to create what are called ledger books. These are drawings. This, of course, was during the era of photography, so we can see photographs of some of these activities, but not quite, because these are by and large portraying very active, often violent scenes of fights between different members of different tribal nations, between Indians and members of the United States Army, the cavalry. Often you can see Native Americans, or rather African Americans, the Buffalo soldiers, the black soldiers who were recruited to fight in the Indian Wars in the 1870s and the early 1880s. So we have two ledger books and have published a couple of them. And this is a catalog from an exhibit that we did. So you'll want to take a look at how the Indians portrayed themselves in particularly active roles. And I think I'll put it over here so more of you can crowd around that. And then finally, take a look at this book, which has so many more photographs than, alas, Tim Egan's book had. One of the things I was frustrated with in Tim Egan's book is I wanted to see more photographs, and so I would, as I was reading it, I was pulling out this book and taking a look at it. So indulge your wish that I suspect you shared with me that there were more photographs there, and take a look at these. You'll see many that were in the Egan book, Short Nights of the Shadow Catcher, but you'll find a lot that worked. And these really begin to give you a sense of just what a genius this guy was at portraying. Again, not just photographing, but portraying the people and their time. This is Princess Angelina, purported to be in her 90s, 95 or 98, something like that. Chief Seattle lived into the middle of the 19th century. He lived up to the time when Seattle was being established, not as a city as we know it, but as a township. and really had some eloquent things to say about how he felt he was being treated, the land essentially being taken from him. He wasn't selling it. It was essentially being taken from him. And he had a very strong sense of ownership of the land that he owned it, but rather the reverse, that the land owned him. And, you know, so he felt there was no way that he could sell it. No one owned it. Yet it was being taken from him and members of his tribe, whom, of course, he was seeing dying from diseases. So he was quite upset about it, but he was obviously a leader. He was articulate. He was quite smart. And some of the quotes that have been made of his words weren't, you know, they weren't what he said, you know, word for word, but clearly this was someone who understood what was going on. So she would have known that when she was much younger. And then, of course, she lived up into the 1890s, so she saw Seattle grow dramatically and passed away just as it was really becoming a big town, if not a bigger city, beginning to vie with Portland, with close to 100,000 people at that time. So you can only imagine what was going through her mind, probably tormented, and the fact that she did sit for Curtis, I think, was a testament to the trust she had in him. So I'm going to stop there and give you time to come up here and take a closer look at some of these materials.